Alright, so next up is Hagai Plotner, and he will talk about the study of quality performance prediction for answer quality determination.
Okay, so this is a work with my colleagues, Shai and Guy. So I will try to put it short because of time. So the motivation is basically there are a lot of cases that we would like to give a single answer to the user, not more than that. So as a motivation, our settings like voice search, where user basically has a limited attention in terms of how much information we can provide to the user. So an intelligent assistant would like to give him a user query, would like to decide whether there is an answer or not. There is not an answer, then maybe it will tell the user that there is no answer or ask for clarifications. The same is in a conversational search setting. So just for related work, this problem, so there is some work on general prediction of user satisfaction in with automated agents. There is one work from last year about conversational search with multi-turns, which basically the authors try to tune a threshold manually. There is more traditional works on answer selection in AR, for example, those work that try to use different features that are not only textual, like non-textual features, adversarial features that take other sample answers and try to compete with these answers. There are works that try to pick relevant answers from a given set of relevant answers. And of course, in the learning to rank literature, there are some works that try to incorporate query performance prediction features, which are basically the core features that we are using for this task. Okay, so the task itself, the asset determination task, is basically, as I said, is given a query and a single answer that is given by the search engine. We would like to assist the bot and let him be more educated whether the answer should be served or not. This problem is, of course, is a kind of a classification problem. And being that we are using in the world three types of feature sets. One is a traditional feature set that everyone recognizes. The tall features, basically, given the answer, they give an estimation on the similarity of the answer to the query, and maybe also some query-independent features like the answer and so on. In this work, we also incorporate two types of QPP features. QPP features, basically QPP is based on an answer set prediction and not a single answer. So there are pre-trivial features that are used before we see the answer set, and post-trivial features, the features that are estimated given that we see the answers. And you may ask yourself, why do you need the answer set level features when you want to classify a single answer? So you can think of it as a kind of a regularization effect that the answer set prediction will give to this task. So the assumption is that a good answer would come from a good answer set. Okay, so this is the logic behind this usage of QPP features. And on top of that, we are using a new set of what we call the answer level QPP features. These features are basically not new. They were derived from a couple of previous works that we had, where we developed two variations of a discriminative QPP framework that can basically be used to derive any QPP, post-trivial QPP method that you are currently know about. For example, you can derive from clarity, wig, and so on. We are using in the paper five different features. Two features are basically comparing the score of the answer to two pseudo ineffective scores. One is the mean score and the other is the corpus score. The other is the log relevance, basically estimates the relevance of the answer based on the answer set and compared to the corpus. And two features that come from a paper that we had last year, and I think it won the best paper. Unfortunately, I didn't come. And it uses two types of two types of passage-level features. One is the passage that comes from the answer itself, and one is novel that comes from the answer set itself, from the answer set. Okay, for the results, so there are a lot of results in the paper for six collections and different tasks. They span from ad hoc search to question answering, long documents, short answer, long answer, and so on. We define different strategies of classification, starting from trivial ones like accept all answers, reject all answers, and of course feature sets that are based on the different feature. Different strategies that are based on the different features that we define and their combination. We also provide feature analysis for each data set that basically shows that at least three of out of these five features appear in the best features for this task. So just some highlights. Utilizing only answer level 2P features is better than utilizing only the top features, which is nice. It means that we discover new features that can replace the top features. And here the idea is that while the top features look only on the answer itself, these new answer level features, if you take a look at the paper, they basically try to compete the answer against some reference point, be it a pseudo-negative or pseudo-effective answer. Utilizing all the utilizing features which are on the answer set level is better for ad hoc than QA settings, and this is also makes sense because in ad hoc setting we have more relevant samples per set, so there are more informative features. And of course the mixed strategy is the best. Okay, for the answer itself, the conclusion is of course the first one is trivial, right? It's a good answer, better represents the information in. A good answer to a score should deviate as much as possible from the pseudo-effective reference point. Again, that basically means that it's important to look at other answers and other reference points in order to be able to judge an answer. And in an ad hoc setting, as I said, the PPT features are much better.